both live tweeting with him.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to today's webinar on Capital Markets Union. Today's presenters are Christopher Stewart Sinclair, Miles Bennett, Laura Wadding, and Aisling Costello. Christopher is going to start off the discussion today, and he will go through, he will take us through a quick overview of the Capital Markets Union itself. So, Chris, if you'd like to begin.
Hello. I'm afraid we can't hear Chris at the moment. We seem to have a technical issue.
The technical issue has been resolved, Ash. So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Laura, for the introduction. Obviously, this is, I might think, Capital Markets Union, a new thing. And yet, as the old proverbial saying goes, there's nothing new under the sun. At a certain extent, what this is a continuum of what we've had before. It's an umbrella heading which is going to cover a number of existing and new work streams, which have been themes which have been within the Financial Markets Action Plan of the EU for some time. The only difference is going to be, perhaps it's going to be a single and directing focus, and at the basis of it, it is all aspects that concern the free movement of capital within the internal market of the EU, and this is something we shouldn't necessarily forget, the implications that may have on the broader world, on the context of the G20 and the G7, and on the overall global trends. So stakeholders within this are not just the European Union, its member states, and its industries, but also bodies like IOSCO, like the FSB, and other supranational, either coordinating bodies or authorities. Not a new idea. The original idea of a Capital Markets Union could be traced back to the Treaty of Rome and the 1966 SEGA report. It does find its origins in the 1999 Financial Services Action Plan. And for the anecdote, interestingly, one of the architects of that action plan was David Wright, who today is at the helm of IOSCO, and obviously a more than interested observer and stakeholder in how this whole thing goes forward. Probably what is different is CMU is a rebranding of this idea. In the current context, in the current market environment, and with a very specific new political dimension, which I think we'll come back to later on, but which is basically a growth forecast. The idea is to use primarily market-based financing as an engine for economic growth. The secondary purpose at the same time of looking at the detail of how that unified capital market can actually not only just be an overall financing vehicle for the EU economy, but also can privilege new sectors, how it can develop, for example, social responsibility investing, how it can develop long-term investment funds as a product, how it can address securitization. So basically, trying to match investor demand with a market offering across the border, across borders within the EU, in the interest of promoting growth and at the same time keeping a watching eye over systemic risk and investor protection and the other themes of the more recent Commission agenda. So if we move forward from those drivers and look at some of the elements involved, we can see that if we could move to the next slide, voila. We can see that basically the Capital Markets Union is what we have in the center of this slide. Basically, looking to diversify sources of funding in the interests of broader economic growth, improve access to funding. Quite often we've seen in the past that the funding is there, but it's not necessarily in the right place in the right time, or there may be too many intermediaries between the lenders and the specific need for financing which can promote growth. And finally, to make sure that the allocation of capital throughout the markets is balanced, not that we end up with an capital running to the closest hot home of the particular period. So in other words, looking at a long-term aspect as well as an opportunistic aspect. The principles have been laid out. Obviously, maximizing growth, increasing or certainly protecting financial stability, to apply across the whole of the European Union, the 28 member states, and to remove barriers across cross-border distribution of capital, with at the same time a watching brief on consumer protection, and at the same time, as I mentioned originally, not to forget the broader aspect. In other words, to try to also make the capital markets union within Europe an attractive place to attract global investment, and potentially to also make European industries more competitive in terms of the export offering in terms of financial markets and the capital markets. The approach, this is interesting, there won't be one huge CMU legislation or initiative. There won't be a single CMU directive or CMU regulation which after 5 or 6 years of discussion, infighting, compromise, change of mind, suddenly comes in and drops on us like a mega IFMD or a mega UCITS 5 or a mega Solvency 2. It will be pragmatic, piece by piece. There will be some new legislation, obviously. There will be some things that can be achieved quickly. There will be some things which are going to be much more longer term. There will be an increased emphasis, hopefully, on impact assessment. The issue we may find with this approach, which is fundamentally pragmatic and likely to get us to an end result sooner rather than later, could well be that we get into a number of loops, and we'll come back to this later on, that some dependencies to really push things forward could get caught up in the detail that they can't be achieved before a bigger piece will go. And I think you'll see the relevance of what I'm trying to say there later on when we talk about some of the responses we're already seeing around long-term pension provision in terms of a way of stimulating markets and the impact that might have on solvency too. So clearly, although you can identify quickly some of the quick wins, the realization of those quick wins may well be dependent on longer term changes and even legislative change. One of the objects of Capital Markets Union is going to be to look at very seriously what the barriers are, and those barriers may be regulatory, they may be national. They may also, though, be in a historical bias, and even unconscious bias, between different markets, such as terms of finance. In other words, equity culture versus a bond-related culture. Private provision, unregulated or less regulated markets versus, shall we say, central provision of services. Now I'm thinking very much in terms of pensions. So again, part of the exercise is going to be identifying those barriers, conscious and unconscious, and then seeing what needs to be done to try to remove them. And we may, and this is one of the paradoxes, we may well find that as we go forward, the whole process of looking at CMU could well throw up barriers of its own, most notably in terms of the different stakeholders not necessarily being always 100% aligned on where we want to be or where we need to be or what the necessary action is going to be. And finally, I would say there's one policy shift which is quite important in understanding the dynamics behind the initiative, and that is that the new European Commission, that headed by Mr. Juncker and Mr. Timmermans, has nailed this Capital Markets Union very close to its policy for economic growth. It's no secret that we're looking at substandard growth in the majority of European markets at the moment, and clearly one of the major objectives for the European Commission is stimulating that growth. So there's a focus on jobs and economic growth, as well as financial stability. There is also a focus on legislative review. One of Mr. Timmermans' specific portfolios is better regulation, and that may well be, and there are some of the early responses making us feel that we may be seeing suggestions of reducing regulation rather than imposing it. That would be an interesting debate as we go forward. And obviously using alternative solutions to achieve the aim, market-driven as opposed to forcibly legislative-driven. And it'll be interesting to see how that works out. But I think the main thing to remember is this has very significant and very serious political impetus behind it. What we thought we would do also is to try to bring up some of the differences between where we're going with CMU and previous cross-border harmonization directives or initiatives such as banking union. And I think this throws up a few of the interesting points that whereas, shall we say, the driver for banking union was very much stability, improving quality and focus on supervision, and interestingly also to try to take out some of the implicit feedback loops that we're seeing there. Here with CMU, we have a definite growth focus, not losing sight of those needs and objectives of stability and a resilient financial system, but at the same time looking at growth as being one of the most important elements of the policy, of the objective. And at the same time, as a secondary, but it is a very, very important one, the means of diversification away from bank financing. One of the characteristics you see when you look at the European Union in general is a very heavy dependency on bank financing versus what you may see in North America or you may see in Asia, where much more finance for economic growth is coming from non-bank finance sources. I don't think the objective, I think we've more or less covered, so I won't talk any more about that. What I would possibly talk about is in terms of the supervision for banking union, one of the clear elements was that this was aimed at giving the ECB the tools it needed through the single supervisory mechanism to centralize authority to look at supervising purely banks. Clearly, when we're talking about CMU, Capital Markets Union, we're talking about a number of entities which may or may not be banks. And if one of our objectives is to move away from bank financing, implicitly, that landscape of who the regulator and who the ultimate authority is beyond the Commission and beyond the instances of the EU becomes more complex. So that is going to be a very interesting debate as we go forward to see how that comes in. And in the first responses we are seeing that have been published to the consultation on CMU, we're already seeing some of the, I'm tempted to say battle lines, but at least intentions being laid out by different stakeholders of where they believe this should go. And of course, we're already seeing that we're far from having consensus on that. And I suppose the other element is clearly banking union was very closely linked to the euro and eurozone countries, because that was obviously the immediate question of contagion that had to be contained, with obviously the proviso at the same time that non-eurozone member states could opt in. CMU is more ambitious. CMU looks to address the whole of the internal market and European Union. If we move on, obviously, I mentioned earlier on, there are some quick things, some longer-term things. A couple of themes come out, and if we've tried to capture these on this particular slide. And these are things which, from the first cut, from the first almost intuitive, the gut technicals approach to Capital Markets Union, are coming to the fore. One is there's a much larger role for alternative finance to play in terms of getting funding to small and medium-sized companies, companies that sometimes are cut off from market finance. There is a role to play for cross-border distribution of certain pooled investment products. We could have added to this also the LTIFs, to LTIFs and UCITS, we could have added alternative investment funds as well. So that's another theme. How you distribute in Europe, the role of passports and private placements. And a number of these themes are going to come up almost immediately. How can you have a cross-border market in things like finance for small and medium-term, medium enterprises, medium companies, if you don't have any common accounting standards? So some of the things that will be looked at in the short term, and this is where I would come back to the comment I made initially, and I'll keep on coming to this, back to this with your permission, is that we cannot actually say this is an initiative which after 5 years we'll see what happens. This is going to be a living initiative. This is going to be something where things can happen almost on a monthly basis. And some of the fruits, some of the problems, some of the results may be with us in a very short space of time. And the first ones we've picked up are the review of the prospectus regime, possibly some harmonization there, how information standards and accounting standards for small and medium enterprises can be better appreciated across Europe. High quality securitization, very high on the UK's list, very high on the ECB's list as to how to develop more liquidity into securitized markets as a means of providing finance across the EU. LTIFs, that is a whole European Long-Term Investment Fund, that is a whole chapter on its own. This is a key pillar to the European Commission's growth strategy, and without prejudging it, at times it's already looking like a solution looking for a problem. There are clearly one of the concerns within the Commission, within this first consultation, is have we got LTIFs right? So that's going to be an interesting one. And finally, as I mentioned earlier on, the overall, how you distribute these different products. They're not going to be listed securities. They're not going to be that top end of the capital markets necessarily. If we're to achieve this aim of getting finance where it's needed in the grassroots economy, clearly that implies looking at private placement arrangements that are in place and then seeing what do we need to do with them, which is counterintuitive to where we've been going on IFMD, for example. So those are some of the things we're likely to see happening fairly quickly. We've summarized them on the next slide into early initiatives, medium-term initiatives, long-term initiatives. I won't insult your intelligence by reading through them. If we just move on to the next slide, that would be useful. And we will see on the next slide, voila, we will see on that slide that what we could likely see, the private placement one we could possibly move on quite quickly, encouraging the uptake of LTIFs. That is very important because clearly that is imminently going to be launched. Medium-term initiatives, how we can promote other forms of financing, particularly the issues of bringing more liquidity to the bond markets, very topical in terms of the end of quantitative easing, potentially in the UK, with now Europe moving into quantitative easing, but at the same time raising some significant issues that how do you actually achieve greater liquidity in certain bond markets. And finally, the long-term things which inevitably are going to come to the fore, insolvency law, how do you harmonize that? Because that's one of the stumbling blocks which is inhibiting development of private equity financing, certainly in the eastern part of Europe and in the developing part of Europe. Pensions. How do we actually use capital markets union, not only to, how does it benefit from the pension paradigm, but how do we actually use it as a potential solution to the pension time bomb? Accounting standards and tax. And I think if I had to pick out two things on that list, the ones I would actually focus on are tax. It's no longer, okay, it won't attack the Pillar 1 responsibility of national states for setting their own fiscal budgets, but tax is not off the table. Tax is not a taboo that can't be talked about. So within CMU, there is the opportunity, it may not take us anywhere, but there's the opportunity to actually raise issues where tax is a constraint on creating a capital markets union. And the other ones are things like pensions, Solvency II, things which are currently causing problems but can't be open for rediscussion. That was very brief. I tried to get over what the objectives are, what the main themes are, and already throw in some of the issues there. But I'd like now to hand over to Miles Bennett and ask Miles to go into a bit more detail as to what the consultation has contained and what the first cuts are of the reactions we're getting to it. Miles?
Yeah. Thank you very much, Christopher. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. So what I'm planning to do is to give something of a UK perspective in terms of the Green Paper. Obviously, within that, there are 32 questions, and I'm not going to get into too much detail in the scope and time of this particular call to go through, if you like, for example, the Bank of England's responses to every single one of those questions. But what I hope to bring over the next couple of minutes is something of the tone in the UK, or particularly from the UK institutions, and particularly obviously Bank of England, and I might reference also the UK government's response to this. And that's really looking at the tone and approach to CMU, so that, as Christopher has just pointed out, we can see some of the intentions of those key stakeholders across Europe. So once I've done, I'll pass over to colleagues in Ireland to bring a different perspective and maybe more of a more sectoral approach. But I'm just going to summarise initially, if you'll allow, some of the key points for me that has come out of the Bank of England response. And I guess the first one is actually the fact that the Bank of England uses the wording, "The Bank of England strongly supports the Capital Markets Union initiative. So that's I think that's obviously that really kind of sets the tone in a positive way. And what the Bank of England focuses on is really the outcome for the CMU to improve the matching of savers and borrowers and the private sector risk sharing. So it's quite a complex way of looking at it, but I think how they look at that is really they're looking for policy measures that really overcome some of the existing impediments, and that's what the focus of the Bank of England is to overcome some of the existing impediments. And how they're looking at that is by focusing on five themes, which to a greater or less extent they believe might address some of those existing impediments or potential impediments to the Capital Markets Union. So one of those themes, and Chris has helpfully referenced some of these already. So one of those themes is bigger, more liquid and stable capital markets. And by that, what they specifically focus on, and that will come up a bit later, I'm sure, is improving the liquidity of corporate credit markets. So that's an important thing. And obviously, the Bank of England references MiFID II in supporting that type of initiative. So clearly, what the Bank of England is looking for is for CMU to deliver greater liquidity in these corporate credit markets. The other theme that it's focusing on is an interesting one in terms of building trust and understanding of market-based finance. So building trust is an interesting one, and I think that and the example there that the Bank of England references is exactly what Chris has mentioned right at the end there, which is reduce barriers to corporate insolvency regimes. So examining the options towards greater consistency of insolvency regimes across Europe. So the Bank of England has definitely picked up on that as one of their priorities. The third theme that they mention is more liquidity, more equity and bonds for smaller firms, so that smaller firms marketplace. They're looking to strengthen, or for the CMU to strengthen the environment for traded equities of smaller companies. So again, developing, as Chris has mentioned, the prospectus, prospectus directive, and developing in particular a pan-EU private placement market. So obviously UK has got already has historically had quite a strong private placement market, so they're looking to develop a pan-EU placement market as part of that theme of more equity and bonds for smaller firms. The fourth theme that the Bank of England talks about is diversifying savings outside the banks. And as Chris has mentioned, that includes incentivizing pension savings. And the example of where the Bank of England are looking to that, it might have obviously some implications for the investment management industry, is A, they're looking at exploring measures such as auto-enrollment and matching contributions in pensions funds, but they're also looking at improving transparency around fee structures and charges to encourage competition and consolidation. And that's already quite a big existing theme in the UK, fees and charges on pension funds and funds in general. So they're looking for the CMU to deliver some more of that. The last theme that I'm going to mention from the Bank of England is leveraging the bank's expertise. And an example they give there is to revive the securitization markets. So they're looking, obviously, for ASCO, EBA, et cetera, proposals on securitization to revive those securitization markets. So those are some of the sort of interesting responses that the Bank of England has put in paper, and it's obviously quite a long paper they've put together. One other interesting aspect on tone has actually come from the UK government, where they have actually responded in quite a short document, but they have actually responded to the UK's Green Paper. Unsurprisingly, it references some of the things that the Bank of England has mentioned. But again, like the Bank of England, the UK response is actually quite positive. It says along the lines of we regard CMU as being critical in terms of importance to building a stronger, more competitive competitive European economy. The UK also, the UK government also mentions, sort of prioritises some of the issues, and they're unsurprisingly not a million miles away from what the Bank of England has touched on. But in terms of what they see as the immediate term issues of focus is what I've just mentioned previously, i.e. restarting the securitisation market. They also talk about lowering barriers to accessing capital markets, and they also talk about supporting a pan-European private placement market, again, as we've touched on. They mention about small and medium enterprise lending, so helping that, and they also talk about removing barriers to funds operating across border. So those are the sort of five sort of near-term things that they see as a important area to focus. But obviously, being UK, there's always some caveats in there. And I think, and Chris has mentioned about some things on stakeholder intentions. And I guess there are some clues there from the UK government's response in terms of intentions. And they mention four areas where they don't see value in progressing a number of measures. And those four areas where they don't see value is A, the transfer of direct supervisory responsibilities to European institutions, B, a 29th regime, I like the use of a number, a 29th regime for harmonization of personal pensions, C, a tax harmonization, and D, the fourth one there is harmonization of insolvency law. So there's a little bit of, there's some common themes obviously emerging, but a little bit of lines in the sand there coming across from the UK government's response. So I think it's kind of watch this space, see, as Chris has said, see how things develop, but we're getting some early indications of what is important for the different countries and the different financial regulators in across the EU and obviously the trade bodies as well. And on that basis, I'm going to pass over to Laura to capture some further responses to CMU.
Thank you. So, I mean, I think the key area for me really is around the funds industry, and not just in Ireland, but the cross-border industry as well. And the response, I guess, to the Green Paper has been overall really positive. And that positivity is driven by some of the challenges that the industry faces today because of the way the market is regulated. So, you know, having maybe disproportionate regulation to the risk that it's trying to mitigate can sometimes be a problem. One regulator potentially racing ahead of the others to say we want to be best in class, we want to have legislation and a regulatory framework in our country that's better than the other countries. And for whatever reason, whether that's driven by some sort of political agenda or in the interest of protecting investors, there's a driver behind it. But one way or the other, it's not particularly helpful. And that wouldn't help with regard to opening up the market and creating a level playing field for the end user and for the end investor. And I think that has to be the goal. And so some of the things that the funds industry has pulled out in response to the Green Paper are around, you know, a harmonisation of regulation, the appropriateness of the regulation, the effectiveness of it, you know, and moving away from having more regulation to a place where we've got better regulation, so that it makes sense, and that it should not be a situation where an investor feels as though it's cheaper and easier to put their money in one EU country over another. And I guess that's the whole point of this. And the goal, I guess, for that end investor, for the industry, is to attract more investment in there. And they need to make it that easy for investors to actually achieve that. And the experience for the investor also has to be a pretty positive one. I mean, there are definite challenges, and we've mentioned things like tax and insolvency, and I can easily see how each individual country would have their own agenda with regard to that type of thing. And if something at an EU level was to result in a reduced tax intake in a country, then I could see how that country would have difficulty accepting that. But I think it's a really positive thing, and something that CMU will actually hopefully provide real advantages to the cross-border industry. There are a few other things that I guess have been pulled out by the funds industry here in response to the Green Paper, and where we see the advantages of CMU. And if there was potential as part of this to reduce the burden of compliance and the burden of reporting, and to harmonise the data that every supervisor and regulator across the EU wants to actually receive in relation to capital movements and investment funds, that would make it easier for firms to comply, because at the moment the cost of regulation is almost prohibitive, and it's the end investor again that gets impacted. So that, you know, the cost of actually providing services, for example, to a collective investment scheme are increasing, and there's nowhere for that cost to be absorbed by the service provider. So ultimately, you know, the collective investment, which is your book of investors, they're the ones that are going to pay for this. So I think it needs to be really important that CMU doesn't do something negative with that and increase the cost of regulation for the service providers and for the investment managers and the investment funds, because that doesn't make things better for investors, and that doesn't attract additional investment into funds. So I think that's going to be a good one to watch. It's going to be really difficult, considering that there are a lot of projects in full swing with regard to changes in regulation at an EU level. And we've mentioned probably most of them. You know, when you look at AIFMD, UCITS, EMIR, the EU Money Market Fund regulation, MiFID II, Solvency II, the list goes on and on and on. AML, how is that going to be impacted when you open up the market? You want to make things easier for investors to actually put their money into an investment fund, for example. But AML regulation is getting tougher, like it's not getting any easier. So all of that needs to be taken into consideration. The insolvency piece is really important. I mean, from an Irish perspective, we know that the central bank here has done something unique very recently, and, you know, legislated for insolvency around collection accounts, where the accounts that are used to collect subscription monies and redemption monies on the way out to an investor. And that's new, and it's outside what some of the other countries are doing. And CMU should hopefully help that type of activity so that, as we said, there would be a level playing field. But I think it's going to take a huge amount of work. I can't see that obviously we know it's not going to be easy. And there are lots of moving parts to this, and they have to start talking to each other. So all of those entities and institutions and regulators and commissions, they have to start talking to each other if they want to achieve harmonisation, and I think that's going to be the key to this.
Thank you, Laura. I've read the response which was submitted by the Central Bank of Ireland, and they echo some of the themes which you mentioned there on behalf of the funds industry in general in Ireland, and also some of the themes mentioned by Miles earlier, which appeared in the responses of the Bank of England and also the UK government. Principally, the creation of an insolvency regime which is harmonised across Europe. That was something that seems to be key in a lot of the responses received. What the central bank thought would be helpful in such a harmonised regime would be predetermined payout rules, which would obviate the need of an administrator to receive court consent to distribute assets. They also think a source of funding for the costs of administration or liquidation of a failed regulated service provider for the distribution of assets, as well as harmonised compensation rules and a compensation fund if assets are not recoverable in full. So that would be interesting if that was able to be instigated across Europe. Two other features which the central bank thought would be key, and which also echo some of the previous themes, were a coherent data strategy. They make the point that at the moment, the collection of data is on a national level. So the 28 different countries in Europe have 28 different regimes for the collection of data. And they suggest it might be sensible to have one centralized regime. They also point out that these separate regimes look for data in different ways. For example, some national competent authorities look for XBRL, while others require XML. So if you have a fund who is reporting to different competent authorities, they have to have a different system for every different country. even though they are reporting on probably the same information to these different national competent authorities. And again, as you mentioned earlier, this this cost is ultimately borne by the investor. Mm-hmm. Is that something? And then, so this information is collected 28 times, potentially, by ESMA, and then it's all given back to ESMA by 28 different national competent authorities, and you have, you know, the that could should perhaps just be done in one unified way. The loan funds then is something that seems to be key. And the harmonisation of a loan fund strategy across Europe. So the central bank mentioned that some countries currently prohibit loan origination by funds, some just don't prohibit it, so by default permit it, and then some, as Ireland recently changed their rules to allow, some countries actively approve their funds to originate loans. So this is something that they thought should be harmonised, and it's something that they think should be encouraged, given the theory behind Capital Markets Union and its purpose to drive the growth of the real economy across Europe, and the importance of establishing strong and stable alternatives to the banking industry. They think that this is the obvious way for this to be implemented. I also had a look at the reply which AIMA submitted. And again, some of those themes are echoed. Again, the possibility for loans to be originated by funds, and also the take-up of the LTIF. They consider the LTIF is a very good development on the European level, and particularly its ability to finance loans. They thought that some ways which would encourage the uptake of these funds would be to give them some of the benefits which, for example, UCITS currently enjoy. They thought that would make them more attractive and more likely to be taken up, for example, by pension funds. They also would encourage the Commission and the Member States to extend any other relevant advantages currently available in national regimes to LTIFs. For example, to look at the tax, which is available to other funds. And they think it would be sensible as well for member states to not charge LTIFs passporting fees. They thought that would be key to their success. The two other features which AIMA thought would be important to be considered as part of CMU is private placement and also the lowering of barriers to funds generally across Europe. With regard to private placement, they point out that foreign money is as good as local money, to put it bluntly. So to close off Europe to overseas investment would not be the most sensible approach. And in that respect, they would encourage the review, for example, the review of the private placement regime under AIFMD at the moment, they would encourage that to be opened up to allow a more level playing field. They also want to emphasize that private placement should not discriminate against funds. At the moment, you have a situation where investment funds are subject to the AIFMD rules, and they're also potentially subject to the prospectus directive. Whereas other issuers are not subject to these types of restrictions. So that puts funds in a hugely disadvantageous situation. So they want that to be looked at, and they are very encouraging of the prospectus directive being considered in this light also. Regarding the lowering of costs for fund managers generally, they wonder whether additional requirements need to be implemented for the LTIF. They consider that AIFMD is sufficient. It already has substantial disclosure requirements, investor protection requirements, and the LTIF itself has a few extras. So in response to the query about whether additional protections need to be put in place, they do not think that that should be the case. They also consider whether the Commission should look at the charging of passporting fees by funds generally. So as you can see, the AIMA approach looked at this from, as can be expected, the investment management industry, and the creation of unity of this market under the CMU, and to ensure that not only is there unity for funds on a country-by-country basis, but that there is also unity with the funds industry and the other capital market participants in the capital market industry. That is something they think that is key. I wonder what you think, Chris, about the responses that you've reviewed.
Thanks, Ash. I was very interested to hear what you were saying on some of the themes, because they really hit up to the responses I've been looking at, notably from EFAMA, the European Fund and Asset Managers Association, which speaks quite authoritatively, I think, in Brussels. Also, for example, some of the Luxembourg contributions, our own contribution. And I think some of the themes do come back to what you were saying. How can we take down some of the barriers to cross-border distribution? The question of fees, registration, the whole process could be simplified. That comes back several times. Do we need more regulation given what we already have? That comes back several times. It's interesting that EFAMA has devoted a lot of its submission to actually talking about MiFID II and where it believes that the Commission and ESMA may have got it wrong and need to go back and have another look at their copy, particularly in terms of making things restrictive. And the theme they also look at in great detail is they are saying that we're looking at Capital Markets Union, we're looking at European investors. Yes, UCITS is a major part, but it's not the only part. And if you look at retail investment in Europe, a lot of it is actually in non-UCITS funds, non-UCITS retail schemes. They exist in many, many countries. Under the MiFID II rules, they would be defined as complex because they are, by definition, AIFs, whereas in reality, they're not complex and they're actually very much a retail product. So that's one of the things that EFAMA is looking to have people look at in more detail. Then there are a couple of themes that come out there on the questions concerning common play, level playing fields, common interpretations, and so forth. One is, yes, the common rule book, that comes back several times, but a common rule book that is intelligent and ensuring a level playing field for asset management versus things like the insurance industry or the banking industry, which would imply looking at some of the discrepancies between inducement policies under MiFID II and inducement policies under IMD II. One theme that does come back a lot, and you probably notice this as well, Solvency II. Solvency II comes up many times where people are talking about how do you promote investment in private equity. You won't while institutions still have the millstone of Solvency II hanging around their necks, and that is also going to be a major problem for LTIFs, because unless there is a revision of the Solvency II provisions concerning infrastructure, then we're going to have major difficulties in persuading any pension-based or insurance-based institutional investor to even look at it. So I think that's a very important thing, and that is coming back time and again in the different responses. The other one, which is quite interesting, and this comes back in both EFAMA's response, is something we picked up on ourselves. If you contrast European capital markets with, shall we say, North America or the superannuation system in Australia, where there's a very high level of retail take-up, and I mean the figures, just to give you an example, and these are quoted in some of the submissions, North America, 34% of savings go into mutual funds. In retail savings. In Australia, we're in similar figures, probably slightly higher. In Europe in general, it's 11%. And the only way we'll really see a step change in that, and this has come out in several submissions, is by moving towards a different form of pension provision based around a defined contribution, possibly mandatory contribution, possibly defined around fund industry. That is one thing which will make the fund industry grow significantly. And it's interesting to see, we were talking about parallels earlier on coming together. One of the things we're seeing which is moving apart, when I reference that back to what Miles was saying about the Bank of England, clearly they are very unkeen to see the European Union begin to look at pension provision as a means of broadening, deepening, and extending the capital market. So a couple of things to watch there. And having just raised that issue of not necessarily everything converging around the same themes and consensus on issues, I think it's interesting to flag as well the ECB's responses, which, whilst seeming to be very positive, there are a few of the fault lines I mentioned earlier on beginning to appear there. And interestingly, they are the only response that I've seen so far which actually comes out and mentions shadow banking. And clearly one of the issues about this, about the whole of the CMU, when we're talking of alternative forms of financing, we're talking of getting private financing directly to small and medium-sized enterprises. That is something that the banking world and the banking regulators have traditionally looked at shadow banking. And the ECB is firing some very clear warning shots that the perils of shadow banking are to be avoided. Another contentious issue where they're definitely not necessarily in step with other submissions is they're saying that, yes, they believe there's a greater role for the ESAs to play, the European Supervisory Authorities to play, and they believe that in the future we may be looking at consolidation of ESAs around one regulatory authority, read between the lines themselves. So we can see that there's not everything joy and happiness in terms of where people are coming to. It's also very interesting that in terms of liquidity, the ECB is seeing T2S, Target 2 Securities, as being really a linchpin, a centerpiece for developing capital markets union, where other responses, UK, continental Europe, seem to be looking at how do you actually get around the provision of liquidity. The fact you're offering an infrastructure won't necessarily give you liquidity. So a couple of themes there. One contradictory theme, if you like, or one contrarian view, is when I look at the asset management answers on is there a greater role for ESAs to play, they're coming at it completely differently. And this comes up to one of the points that you mentioned, Laura, earlier on. One of the submissions I read about the greater enhanced role for ESAs is, yes, if they're given the power to stop countries from gold plating. Whereas I think in the regulator's mind from, shall we say, the ECB, it's give them more powers to be more restrictive. So clearly one of the battle lines we're getting is liberality versus restrictiveness. And one other point obviously that comes up in the Luxembourg submission, the Pharma submission, several other submissions, yes, you do have a passport, but it's not a full passport. You can't automatically go there and say, here's my UCITS, I want to sell it. You have these maintenance fees, registration proposals, and you have marketing restrictions. And one of the things that would be very, very nice, and this comes out in a lot of responses, would be to have just a simple process. And this may be centralized on ESMA, perhaps. That's one suggestion which has been in there, that you just notify your UCITS to ESMA, and then you're away. So lots of food for thought. We are beginning to see contention. We are beginning to see the political lines drawing up. But the two themes that I would pick up on that, which are very interesting and very much come back, two themes are one fact. The themes solvency to pension provision, people linking those two together for the development of a broader and deeper fund market. And level playing field being the second, between industries, between the asset management industry, the insurance industry, the banking industry. And I would go back to that point of the Pharma presentation, Pharma submission on MiFID II. Some groups are taking this, and some entities, say, stakeholders are taking this as an opportunity to go back and invite the regulator, invite the legislator to rethink some of the things. And I think, hand on heart, we can all think of things in IFMD, we can all think of things in MiFID II, when we read them and when we see them to be implemented, we think they got that wrong. So perhaps there's a chance that the debate around CMU will allow us to go back and revisit some of these things. Back to you, Ash.
Thank you, Chris. I'll just mention that ESMA released their, or rather published their submission today, and some of the key points which they made in their submission was that they recognise that CMU is not about more supervision and is not asking for more areas of direct supervision. Instead, they say that they are ready to assume such new tasks should the co-legislature wish to assign them, and to ESMA together with the appropriate resources. They say that they are working and that they're going to increase their focus on supervisory convergence, utilising the powers which they've already been given under the ESMA regulation, so they want to use that more. They also stress that they would welcome some clarifications on this ESMA regulation and on the role of ESMA versus national competent authorities to clarify how they work together. They think that would help. They make some recommendations regarding UCITS. So it's interesting that you said there that that was something that has been thrown up in some of the responses that you've seen, Chris. For example, they consider aligning the kids under UCITS with PRIPs. They also consider clarifying the permitted types of additional requirements at national level for cross-border marketing. And they would particularly welcome the launch of an exercise to identify any tax-related obstacles to cross-border fund mergers. So it's quite interesting to see the approach that they're taking. It's not exactly the same as the approaches that we've seen from the other responses that we reviewed earlier today.
So Ash, maybe we'll just close out then with some food for thought. So, and I think probably most of it has been covered in some shape or form throughout the discussion. But in general, you know, we know that there's, or at least there's no evidence of an appetite for a single supervisor. So it will be interesting to see how supervisory authorities will converge on some of this and work together to make it very effective. You know, that there's going to be institutional change within the commissioners, which will have to be addressed, and there's the political element of this, which I won't underestimate at all. And I think that's going to be key, again, to ensuring the effectiveness of CMU overall. All the existing legislation that's either in progress or planned or contemplated, that's the bit that's going to have to tie in nicely as well, to see how it can all come together. You've got your culture barriers, and, you know, there's that old chestnut of the balance between growth and stability. You know, if you're going to make credit more readily available, we all know what could happen there. So making sure that doesn't happen again is going to be absolutely key as well. So there's certainly a lot of big issues and big considerations that still have to play out as this develops.
Thank you very
and
much.
And if I may, Laura, I'd actually throw in something else there, which is going to be quite fascinating, which is a bit the elephant in the room that nobody wants to talk about. We do have the spectre of Brexit, the UK referendum, hanging over a lot of this in two different ways. One is, interestingly, where the UK's position, because it's quite key to the UK financial sector, how that pans out in translating into European thinking. And at the same time, we have the very interesting point that Lord Hill, Jonathan Hill, who is responsible for trying to push this whole initiative forward, is, of course, the UK Commissioner. And so he could be in a very difficult position himself in trying to pilot it through. Interestingly, for such a key initiative, it is within his new, and his directorate is smaller than that occupied by Barnier, a couple of functions to be taken away. So what is a key European initiative, key to European growth, specifically key to Eurozone growth, is in the hands of a UK commissioner who may or may not find himself in the situation of the UK negotiating an exit. So some interesting undercurrents going on there already, and some interesting food for thought in terms of definite clashes ahead of us with regards to different attitudes to regulation, more, less centralized, decentralized. And I think the one thing which is coming across very clearly is, I come to back to something I said earlier, this isn't something where you can go away and thinking, this is like IFMD, this is like MiFID II, we'll talk about it for 2 years, argue about the details for 2 years, then we'll get a package, then we can implement it. It's not on my horizon yet. I don't have to worry. This is, well, it could go one of two ways. It could be the biggest damp squib in history, go nowhere, just end up in a lot of pious talk with no real initiatives, or it could be a groundbreaker, either a good one or a bad one. But if something the industry, any industry, but particularly the asset management industry, cannot afford to ignore and needs to be in either directly or through industry associations from the start to make sure the voices are heard. Because there are opportunities, huge opportunities, but there are also some pretty bad threats out there if we get it wrong or if we're not conscious of some of the interest groups who are going to be very active in trying to advance their industry's positioning or their interpretation of how this can work out.
Okay, thank you for that, Chris. So we've now arrived at the end of our webinar. I would just like to thank all of our presenters today and for sharing their insights into the Capital Market Union. I would also like to thank you for your time this evening. And just before we finish, just to advise you that our next Link and Learn session will take place next Thursday, the 28th, at 4 p.m., and it will discuss AMIR. So just on the agenda for next week, the webinar will cover the current status of AMIR, so where do we stand on implementation and the final technical rules, what is still outstanding, future challenges, and finally, the SFTR, what it is, what does it do, what is the expected time frame, and what should the market be thinking about now. Again, thank you very much for your time this evening, and that's all.